morning and welcome to Benicia Lutheran Church. I'm Pastor Philip Kohmeyer serving you today. Just a couple announcements before we begin. Want to remind you that at 9 a.m. each Sunday, we have a series Bible study, and the topic currently is prayer. And today at 10:30, we have our drive-up communion service from 10:30 to 11:30. And then we also have a Zoom Bible study on discipleship on Wednesdays at 7 p.m. Both the 9 a.m. Sunday Bible study and the Wednesday 7 p.m. Zoom Bible study, both are recorded, so you can catch them at our website if you aren't able to join us live. Thank you. May God bless our worship service. And we begin in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let's take a brief moment to consider our need for forgiveness, our brokenness, reflecting on our life and God's word. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us. And for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. We pray, O God, through the humiliation of your Son, you raised up the fallen world. Grant to your faithful people, rescued from the peril of everlasting death, perpetual gladness and eternal joys through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
First reading for the third Sunday of Easter is from Acts chapter 3, beginning at the 11th verse. When he clung to Peter and John, all the people, utterly astounded, ran together to them in the portico called Solomon's. And when Peter saw it, he addressed the people, "Men of Israel, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety that we have made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, and the God of our fathers glorified his servant Jesus when you delivered over and denied in his presence, in the presence of Pilate, when he had decided to release him. But you denied the holy and righteous one and asked for a murder to be granted to you. And you killed the author of whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses. By the faith of his name has made the man strong whom you see and know. And the faith that as though Jesus has given the man this perfect health were in the presence of you all. And now, brethren, I know that you acted in ignorance and also did your rulers. But what God foretold by the mouth of all of his prophets, that the Christ would suffer, for this was fulfilled. Repent, therefore, and turn back, that your sins may be blotted out, but that and times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send the Christ appointed to you, Jesus, whom heaven must receive until the time for restoring all the things about which God spoke to the mouth of the holy prophets long ago. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The second reading is from 1 John chapter 3, beginning at the first verse. See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God, and so we are. The reason why the world does not know us, it is but that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. He has not yet appeared, but we know that when the appearance we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. And everyone who thus hopes in him purifies himself as he is pure. Everyone who makes a practice of sinning also practices lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he appeared in order to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him keeps on sinning. No one who keeps on sinning has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Whosoever practices righteousness is righteous, as he is righteous. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel for this Sunday, the third Sunday of Easter, is another one of the resurrection appearances of Jesus to the disciples. It's recorded in the Gospel of Luke, the 24th chapter, beginning with the 36th verse. As they were talking about these things, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace to you." But they were startled and frightened and thought they saw a spirit. And he said to them, "Why are you troubled, and why do doubts arise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself? Touch me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they still disbelieved for joy and were marveling, he said to them, "Have you anything to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate before them. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures and said to them, "Thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you. But stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. The basis of our meditation today is the gospel reading, and I'd like us to focus on the last few verses of that reading, and I will reread them right now. Luke 24, verses 45 and following. "Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures and said to them, 'Thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you, but stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high.'" You know, one of my favorite Christian musicals is Godspell. And in that musical, one of my favorite songs is that one, "Day by Day." Many of you, I'm sure, remember it. Goes, "Day by day, day by day, oh dear Lord, three things I pray: to see thee more clearly, love thee more dearly, follow thee more nearly, day by day. Day by day, day by day, oh dear Lord, three things I pray: to see thee more clearly, love thee more dearly, follow thee more nearly, day by day, day by day, day by day." You know, after reading that gospel reading numerous times over the past week, after reading commentaries and listening to numerous sermons on the text, it came to me that maybe this song, "Day by Day, These Three Things I Pray," really fit pretty well with what those last few verses of that gospel reading are speaking about. Now, if you find it doesn't work, that's because of Philip Kohlmeier. If it does work for you, if it communicates, that must be a thing of God. But let's look at that. You know, when you read the Gospels, one of the things that strikes anyone in just a cursory reading is that so much of the Gospels, whether you're looking at Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John, so much of the Gospels are talking about the suffering and death of Jesus Christ and his resurrection. They're talking about what happened in the last couple weeks of his life, you might say. Now, when we go and read a modern biography, the last chapter or two may have something about the death of the person that's being featured, but it would be more about the life of that individual. But I guess the Gospels emphasize the last couple weeks of Jesus' life so much is because they are so important. Indeed, we read the Gospels, and from the very beginning, we get this idea that Jesus did not come to earth so much to live on this earth as to suffer and die on this earth for us and for our salvation. He came not to be served as Matthew and Mark say, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. And when we think of that as his purpose, and when we think of how Jesus in this gospel reading says he, in a sense, expounded, he made clear by the power of the Holy Spirit what the scriptures were saying about him and how Jesus was the fulfillment of all those Old Testament prophecies and predictions and promises, then it takes us to that first theme of that song, Day by Day, with that expression, to see thee more clearly. So we have an emphasis on the gospel, approximately a third of each gospel, devoted to this culmination of Jesus' life here on earth and how it fits together in the whole plan of salvation from Genesis onward, that we might see him more clearly. And then the gospel reading continues on, and it speaks about this repentance and forgiveness of sins. Repentance and forgiveness of sins. They're both gifts of God. The Holy Spirit gives them. We don't really make up our own mind with our own kind of research or mental investigation that we should necessarily repent. Oh, to be sure, the alcoholic does reach a bottom, typically, at which point he decides, you know, this isn't working out and I need to change. But God uses those bottoms in our life that we might turn around. And so the way Scripture presents repentance, that in itself is a gift of God. You know, one of those major characters in the Old Testament is David, isn't it? King David, the giant slayer. He was a man after God's own heart, Scripture says, but he says certainly wasn't always living a life in harmony with God's will, was he? And remember when Nathan the prophet confronted David after his sin of taking Bathsheba, the wife of this loyal warrior in David's army, that Nathan confronted David, and after the confrontation, David is crushed. He realizes that he is a sinner. God works in him to respond with repentance and also with faith and also with forgiveness. For with repentance and faith in the merciful God, as we know in Jesus Christ, we have a new beginning, a fresh start. We're set free from the curse of sin. You know, sometimes it seems like the Holy Spirit works in us like some mystery in terms of a GPS calculator, where, you know, the GPS device that we use in our vehicles and our cell phones and so forth tell us where we should go to reach our destination. But sometimes we make a mistake, don't we? We misjudge the distance, we turn the wrong road, and then the GPS device tells us recalculating. And the Holy Spirit, as we live out our life, frequently has to communicate with us too that we are in need of re-evaluating our life, living a different way, going a different direction, repenting, we might say. We need to get back on track. And sometimes that might be humbling, even humiliating, but that's part of our life, isn't it? It's part of our sanctification process. If you were in prison for some crime that you committed and you received a presidential pardon, wouldn't that be such a gift? Wouldn't you be filled with appreciation? You might even say love for the president who issued that pardon. Wouldn't you feel grateful, eternally grateful, we might say? And that's what God has done for us in the Holy Spirit, in the gift of His Son, Jesus Christ. God has given us the gift of forgiveness and new life. A clean slate. Like David said when he responded from Nathan's confrontation, he said, "Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered." Indeed, God's mercy does forgive us and sets us free. And that elicits from us a response of love, which brings us to that second thing for which the songwriter prays, that I might love thee more dearly. Yes, God loves us, and we respond with love when we realize the great love with which He loves us. Not just a passing comment, but the Word made flesh who suffered all things for us, even death itself, for us and for our salvation. But our gospel is not over. It speaks also about the idea that this repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed, to be communicated to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. In other words, we are to continue the mission, the discipleship, the purpose that God called us in the first place. Even in the Old Testament, the children of Israel, the people of God, were to share God's message. They were to be a light to the Gentiles. And in the New Testament, in the Gospels, in the commissioning that we have at the end of Matthew, that great commission, "Go ye therefore and teach all nations, there is no restriction." You and I in our day don't have to go to some foreign mission field to do that, do we? Because the nations of the world are coming to us. And if we have a Christian congregation in a community, isn't that congregation supposed to be reflective of the community in which it is located? In other words, if there's multiple ethnicities, races in the neighborhood around the church, that congregation should represent those multi-nationalities in its makeup. If there's older people and younger people, the congregation should also be multi-generational. Indeed, the most appealing congregations are those that are multi-ethnic, multi-generational, multi-economically, multi-educationally, but they are all one in Christ Jesus. And we are to share the love that God has given us, aren't we? We are to love as He first loved us. We are to share the forgiveness. We pray in the Lord's Prayer, "Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us." But it's not just we are to share that gospel with outsiders, but You all have family members, maybe even children and grandchildren, who have not followed through on the faith, the gospel, that maybe was shared with them in some earlier years. And that doesn't get us off the hook. Oh, we're not responsible in one sense for another person's life, but in another sense, we are responsible with being a follower, a disciple of Jesus Christ, aren't we? Who loves without thought of receiving return, who wants to communicate the message that honors our Father in heaven, the Creator of the universe, and the Redeemer, and the Holy Spirit, who has worked faith and hope and love and joy and peace in us. And so many of us, perhaps we could say all of us, have to be like the mother of St. Augustine, who had lived a rather prodigal young life, and how his mother prayed and prayed consistently and persistently for years for the conversion of her son, which finally did happen. And he became not just a Christian, but he became a leading Christian leader in the whole early Christian church, a leading theologian that Protestants and Roman Catholics both appreciate. So we have a concern to reach out to family and others. It's one of the most important things of our life, isn't it? To share that gospel in a loving, caring way, to pray that that gospel might be real, that the Holy Spirit might work in the hearts and the minds of our loved ones, as well as all nations, all peoples around us. To identify that last phrase of that song, that we might follow thee more dearly. Yes, three things we pray, that we might love thee, see thee more clearly, love thee more dearly, and follow thee more nearly, day by day. May God grant that to each of us. Amen.
The cross, where grace and suffering meet. You have shown me your love through the judgment you received, and you've won my heart. Yes, you've won my heart. Now I can trade these ashes in for beauty, and wear forgiveness like a crown, coming to kiss the feet of mercy. I lay every burden down at the foot of the cross. At the foot of the cross, where I am made given me life through the death you bore for me, and you've won my heart. Yes, you've won my heart. Now I can trade these ashes in for beauty, and wear forgiveness like a crown, coming to kiss the feet of mercy. I lay every burden down at the foot of the cross. At the foot of the cross, where grace and suffering meet. show me your love through the judgment you received, and you've won my heart. Yes, you've won my heart. Now I can trade these ashes in for beauty and wear forgiveness like a crown. Coming to kiss the feet of mercy, I lay every burden down at the foot of the cross. Trade these ashes in for beauty and wear forgiveness like a crown. Coming to kiss the feet of mercy, I lay every burden down. I lay every burden down at the foot of the cross, where grace and suffering meet.
We pray. Father, we thank you for the life you've given us. We thank you for the families in which you have placed us. They may not have been our choice if it were up to us, but your choice, your good and gracious will, is always best. We pray that you will help us to connect in meaningful, loving ways with our family members. We pray that we might somehow balance our life, our time, our energy, according to your loving will, between family members and those who are outsiders, who are different than we are. Maybe different in ethnicity, in racial background, in education, in interests, in countless ways. But we pray, O Lord, that we might connect with them and put energy into being a blessing to them, even as we are putting energy into our own family, seeking to be a blessing to our family. Help us to get that right balance, O Lord, as individuals and as a congregation, as Benicia Lutheran Church. We pray, Lord, for your Holy Spirit to guide us into all truth. Your word is truth, and your word became flesh, became a human being, abiding with us. And now that he has been raised from the dead, ascended into heaven, that he dwells within us, that the Spirit of Jesus Christ abides in the heart of all of your people. Help us, Lord. Guide us, Lord. Comfort us, strengthen us, equip us. For we would like to see you clearly, love you dearly, and follow you closely. Help us to be faithful people. We pray not only for ourselves, our loved ones, and those around us, we pray for our nation, for our divided nation, our divided world, our broken world. We pray, O Lord, for the leaders throughout the world, in all the communities in our nation and in our world. We pray that you will use them for your holy purposes, that your good and gracious will be carried out. We pray, O Lord, that you will continue to forgive us our sins, but that you will not merely cleanse us of all iniquities, but that you will help us to grow in our life, our walk with you. We ask these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Receive the benediction of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Go in peace. Serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Thanks again for joining us. Hopefully the message was helpful for you. But you know, the message really doesn't make much difference unless it changes, enables us to do a better job of honoring God with our life, of being a blessing to those that He places before us. And to really grow in our walk, to see Him better, more clearly, to love Him more, and to serve Him, follow Him more faithfully, requires that we use the means of grace that God has given us. His Word, the Word that we can read in Scripture, the Word that we hear, the Word that we eat and drink in the sacrament like we do in the communion service, and also through prayer, where God speaks to us, communicates with us, even as we communicate with Him. So I encourage you to really take advantage of the opportunities of growing in your walk with God. Life goes by so quickly, doesn't it? So seize the day. Make use of each day to be a blessing to your family and to be a blessing to those that are different in a wide variety of ways. Lord, in your mercy, help us. Thank you.